know, papers and even some fabrics, cardboard. So I went through phases of experimenting with different collage, but now essentially it's all paint. Just some of it's been dried and collaged on. So let's see if we can get the other one off here. It actually comes off okay if I wait a pretty long time. I think I've probably waited a long time on this one. The trick is, and this was kind of weird, is the palette knife has to be such that it's kind of a smooth poly, versus the newer joint knives are more of a rough surface, and I couldn't peel them off. So I had to actually go on the internet and find, order different palette joint knives from different hardware stores, and find one that worked, and I did. So I have new ones, and I know where to get more, but I kind of freaked out for a while. What actually happens is I have some in my space where the edges are rounded, because I've used them so much, and I need that straight edge. So they almost become like a rounded edge.
So is the foot technique at the beginning, or all through the painting, or?
As far as
I see, you're using that little palette knife. You must be do that with your hand.
Oh yeah, I would use these with my hand, and this would be more for smaller bits of the canvas. Sometimes I'll do another under the main horizontal band. I'll come in with another line, and I usually would do it in one swipe, like that, about that size.
I never wash them off, huh?
I don't have to wash brushes, and I don't have to wash anything.
I hate washing brushes.
Okay, here's another one. That's a nice red one. Other side. So. Both sides are pretty good on that one. So, you know, that's essentially what I do is, I don't do every piece this way. It's one of the ways I'll do a piece. Typically with this, it becomes a horizontal band piece where there's three sections. Recently, I actually did one like this, and then I flipped it around 180 degrees. So it would be more like, this would be on the bottom from your perspective. And that was the first time that I did that. I didn't put it that way intentionally. I think it's a way of leading up to doing that, possibly having this be in the bottom of the horizontal band, and then possibly having this on both sides. I can see that happening. But it was an artist friend of mine who talked me into flipping this other piece 180, which I've done a few times, but in this case it really did work better that way. So I had to re-sign it. And after the signature's down, I'm like, I better be certain about this if you're gonna make me re-sign it. Let's see here. All right, well, I'll start, I think I'll start this other side, and then it's only 28. So this is a parchment color of the thicker Liquitex. I don't know if, what brands you guys use, but this is what I like for like the thicker end of acrylic. Then this is like the basics, more of the thinner brand of the Liquitex. And this is a unbleached titanium. This is actually a new color in basics. And you can see how these are pretty close, and I like having just two colors that are just barely different. And then you'll find like the same color in different brands can actually be different. So one brand's color and another brand, same color, can be a lot different.
Are you influenced by what's on the underneath this when you put your color down?
Not really. I'm not really looking at the background now until I start actually moving the paint, then I kind of start to look at that.
So now what is this that you're putting on?
This is the thin, really the student grade Blick acrylic.
Okay.
Which I like a lot because it's thin and it covers a large area. And when I initially started the style transformation in about 2008, these paints were a big part of it. Because what I found I could do is, rather than, you know, put down random little bits of paint and then kind of nurture each little character, how I used to do with the brush, I would put down multi colors of paint and then use the large palette knife to just swoosh it over. And you can't really do that with this stuff, or you could, but you need a lot of it. So now what I do is I mix it. And there's other brands of this, kind of thinner. I think this is the stuff from Blick, the stuff I've been using, but I think there's a few new brands out like that.
Repeat the name of that, would you, what that is?
This is the economy acrylic, Blick acrylic from Blick.
It's clear.
Yeah, it's cheap.
Yeah.
It's clear?
Oh no, this is white. This is titanium white.
Okay.
And I use this in everything. I always use this kind of white in probably every piece.
How about gesso?
I get the canvases pre-gesso. I don't use gesso.
You don't use gesso as a white there?
No.
Is there a reason why?
Not really.
No.
I just got used to using this stuff. This is the titanium white. There's also blackout white, I think.
Yeah.
But it's just, I like to mix white rather than bringing dark into a lighter color. I like to bring white into a darker color.
Oh, okay.
What I do, once in a while, I'll throw a little bit of black in the initial mixes just to get some quick little dots of darkness, but when I'm trying to hit a color, I usually go darker and then I bring it up with white. Thank you.
because of this technique, you tend to be more square geometric than circular, or do you adjust to be circular?
Yeah, more square geometric, and my older work would be maybe more forms and characters happening, but always, you know, emphasis on vertical and horizontal lines. And that comes from the Hans-Hoffmann influence, the push-pull, pushing and pulling the paint. Now my current work, I do have some circular work, and typically it'll just pop up here and there, like these jagged things that happen. These are pretty geometric here, but there might be more diagonals, and usually not like a true circle. I have a couple that where it just happened, and I just let it happen. But what I'll do sometimes in the early layer is I will usually use this thinner acrylic, and if I wasn't doing the collage start to this, the paint skin process, I would put down paint in a circular motion sometimes, and as I scrape it around, sometimes I will leave some of that circular motion, and then what happens is it'll dry that way, and then as I paint over it, you see that in the texture. So you see a hint of a circle, but it's more the texture of the dried drip versus a, you know, clear, hey, this is a circle, because it would be on the underneath layers. So I think I probably intentionally will do that, just to add a little bit of interest to it that way, have that kind of motion in the background. So like this form here, here's something that I would scuffle over, and I'll do that right now. So what happens with the thinner acrylic when I do that process, you get the obvious parallel lines, approximate parallel lines, then you get a little bit of drips, so you get that vertical connection too. So I like that, I'll probably leave that, that's pretty good. And that's just part of my process that came along probably in 2006 or so, seven. So that was before the shoe technique. And with the shoe technique, I can't really scuffle. I mean, I can kind of, but that's always kind of the second part, you know, doing this scrape, chop, 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 like that. Okay, this is really nice. This pink and blue underneath is really nice. I'll probably leave that. When I underpaint,
yeah.
I usually don't. I mean, I probably instinctively put down colors that I know will work well together, but I try to, I'll even randomly pick from my paints and just pick and just do whatever I grab, I'll use. Usually solid colors, I don't do much white or black, a little bit to mix, but I try to not have like too much of a formula to it. I kind of try to make it hard and then try to solve it, I guess, afterwards.
You actually use your canvas as a palette.
Yeah, I do. And yeah. If I ever have excess paint that goes onto another blank canvas, if I ever, I always have a blank canvas around. So yeah, I use it as a palette. And that kind of, you know, creates new problems and interesting things that happen to you.
Yeah, so. Right.
Do you have more than one going at a time?
I have two easels in my space, and they're the nice big ones that I can turn from flat to horizontal, you know, vertical. And I usually have two going on that, maybe a third on the floor that I'm starting. So I might be finishing up two and starting another one. Right now I have a 40 by 80 diptych on the floor going, and I have a 40 by 40 on the easel that I keep thinking I'm done, and I keep making little changes to it. It's purple, and purple's hard. I had to kind of force myself to decide to do a purple one just for a challenge, and I'm happy with it, but it was pretty hard.
What made it hard?
It's a pretty bold color.
Yeah.
I mean, I can paint red, blue, and yellow primary stuff all day. I mean, no problem. Green, probably the next easiest, and then orange and purple. Just because they demand so much from you, and the purple piece I'm doing was initially all purple, like a deep violet, and I had to put neutral on the top. This is too much.
Oh.
So I came back and put kind of a parchment color on the top of it, and then I incorporated some lighter purple with a deeper purple, and then this kind of central character occurred. There is a horizontal band, and then this character's kind of hanging down from it. So it's a very different piece, a lot of action in it. But I usually avoid purple, I think, for the most part. You might get little bits of it. This is a nice blue. It has a purple feel to it, but it's more of a blue. And there's a light purple that I use, that kind of like the light purple on this palette knife. Actually, that's from that other piece I did. And I can use that a lot, but like a deep violet purple, like a Vikings purple. It's tough. It's really tough.
So you don't pre-mix, like if you wanted to get a lower intensity of a color. You don't.
If I do, it's on the canvas.
Pardon? It's on the canvas.
Yeah, I'd never mix it outside.
Okay.
I'd never mix any paint in a little cup or anything.
You don't?
Okay. I'd never do that.
Okay.
Yeah. So. It's about 5 to 8, so take a few questions.
Yeah. Anytime you want to break, when it's a good break for you, it's fine with us. So
okay.
Flexible. So whenever people have some more questions, and then maybe we have a break.
Yeah, any more?
And then we'll start again. So are there any more questions?
How much does the big one you're doing in purple,
how much is
that going to sell for? Oh, she wants
a
purple paint.
40 by 40?
I'm thinking the legislature needs a purple paint.
Oh, okay.
Any questions before we get started?